Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, or actually good afternoon, and we are ready to continue in our illumination of Mr. Herschell Turner's collection here at the Sedona Arts Academy. We've heard from a couple of really lovely guests prior, Mr. Larry Harper, a longtime friend of Mr. Herschell Turner's, also Alejandra Richards of Thai Kitchen, and we continue with Miss Karen Loomis. Karen, No Moss Brands, and has the synchronicity or the connection to today's event that she is the curator of all of the art through the Turner estate or through Mr. Turner via the help of Mr. Harper, as I understand it.
All because correct? Of Mr. Harper.
Due to Mr. Harper. There yeah. You are. And so, interestingly, though, as we were speaking earlier, and I was coming up to speed about the collection of Mr. Turner, you were telling me about the significance of and the rarity of this collection, not only in its range, but in its construct. Could you tell me a little bit more about that and maybe tell us what or how it was that you became really associated with Mr. Turner and his artwork? And by the way, thank you for being here, and thank you for allowing us to interview you for this event.
Thank you for being here. And thank Larry. We have a lot of people to thank, actually, for this. But I especially thank Larry Harper, who has been my client for the last, 5 years, probably, Larry. And so Larry came to me last year, sometime November, with Herschell Turner's website that needed to be built. And so that is where I became very familiar with the artwork, is as a result of building the website. So I've spent the last year literally loving his work online. And so Camilla and I have done quite a bit of work from a perspective of social change, and we were talking about Black History Month and talking about how can we as nonprofits partner up, which is, you know, always a way to give a big bang to things. And so that's how we ended up here. And that's how I ended up as the art curator, which is a title that I've never had before, primarily because I've never had this opportunity. I'm one of those people who looks for opportunities, and this opportunity to display Herschell Turner's artwork and to continue his legacy. That's really important to both Camilla and I.
So No Moss Brands is a marketing firm?
Yes. Yeah, marketing and branding
digital,
firm.
Digital, yep. All aspects of marketing.
Yeah, so I started marketing as my second career. So I'm 20 plus years into this second career, and where I'm at with this career is making the decision to choose who my clients are going to be, choose the types of work that I'm going to participate in. And so that's why this Herschell Turner art exhibit and show has been very important to me, because it's a chance for me to deliver back to the community, the African-American community, and try to help, you know, lift up the community and give the community the notoriety that really often we don't get.
So it sounds as though Mr. Turner's collection is offering you a little bit of, or a lot of exceptionality in your work, in that your clients are different brands than artists.
He's my first artist. Yeah. So, I mean, it's a pretty bad artist to have first, right? I mean, like, if you're going to have to go down the path that you've never gone down before, at least fall in love with what you're going to do. And that's really what's been very important to me for marketing, is to really want to do good by it and not just to make people wealthier, right? Because marketing you often think of as building a business. But in this case, this is not about revenue. This is about how can we expose Herschell Turner's artwork to more people? And that's the bottom line. It's that simple.
Absolutely. And absolutely. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. And so as having this as your first client and then seeing the images come through to you in some way, can you talk to us about the emotion or if it was, because I think that we spoke a bit earlier and you were saying that a part of your reaction to having received the images, you were kind of struck about the emotionality that you experienced when just even before understanding, you know, the exact technical components.
Right. Yeah, so it's interesting. So I spent the last year with just Larry and I knowing about Herschell Turner. And so when we decided that we were going to move forward with the exhibit, then that gave me the chance to have a few people near me enjoy his work and the emotion involved. And so what I discovered is, after living with his work digitally for the last year, that's nothing like seeing it in print. And when I went to the framer, we were using Framing Works out of Phoenix, Arizona, who I've worked with before from a marketing perspective back in my corporate career, he managed to do a fantastic job stretching and framing this canvas to be ready for this show. And so when I was down there, he pulled back a few of the pieces that they had already had done, and it was the first time I had seen Herschell Turner's work in flesh and blood versus off screen. And I just was kind of taken back by the level of emotion that the pieces bring out of you. Like, what I've discovered is, the more and more people that I expose his art to, there's always that one piece that speaks to you. Hopefully there's more than one piece. But there's always that one piece that kind of follows you around. I'm up to three right now, by the way. So there's always that one piece that speaks to you. Just can't stop thinking about it, talking about it, looking at it. And I'm sure that you guys have all had that same kind of experience where you're just kind of taken back with the detail. You know, we talked about the fact that Herschell calls himself a cover photo artist, so he'll take a photo and duplicate it as though it was almost the photo itself. So you look at like the Obama or Martin Luther King, which are the photos that we're all used to seeing, but when you see them from an artist's perspective, from the talent, from his ability to precisely replicate these photos, it's remarkable. And I don't know about you guys, but I consider myself a technical artist, so I'm great on, you know, in the online world. But to do this, what we're seeing here, I can't. And so I'm just dumbfounded by the talent of Herschell Turner.
And then, so can you talk to us about the process of onboarding these images, and if there was maybe a particular lean in or some particular attention to detail that Mr. Turner directed you to in providing your services to him?
Well, the beauty of this, I'm going to say this because this is the truth. The beauty of this scenario is that I only have really two bosses, Larry and Herschell. And Herschell goes through Larry. Oh, wait, I should say third. I should add Julia, shouldn't I? The wife, right, Julia Turner. And so...
Happy wife, happy artist.
Right? And so I want to really make sure that what we are doing, that they're proud of, and that they themselves can look back at Herschell's life and say it wasn't a life that... you know, that is lost. It's going to be a life that's going to continue to live even long after Herschell Turner. And, you know, and that's one of the things that I can't help but think about is somebody who has this level of creativity in them, what would it be like to lose that ability to express yourself in this way? And so if you'll notice on the video, the tribute video, he had mentioned that was one of the questions that we asked him was, you know, how are you able to express yourself with, you know, with all, you know, even with your blindness? And he admitted that, you know, attitudinally, is that a word? Attitudinally, that is an issue, that he, you know, that there, he's not able to do the creative expression that he's done for his whole life. And so that in itself is kind of sad, to think about not being able to continue to express this and not to be able to finish the many paintings that he has. He had mentioned to Larry and I that one of the things that he does is, you know, many of us read multiple books at a time. Many artists will paint many different pieces at one time. And so it just makes me sad to think that there are some pieces in his house that are not going to ever be finished. And truthfully, you know, that legacy is what we need to keep pushing forward to make sure that it doesn't die.
So this is the context, right? This is the context that we were talking about with Mr. Harper, is because you have so many facets that are of exceptionality that have an intersection through Mr. Turner, and then how poignant. I mean, one would think, I was speaking with Mr. Harper as well, that it's an interesting thing that the topics that he was trying to convey through his life arc. I mean, as he was one of the rare African American players on the Nebraska University team, and then coming through this arc of civil rights, choosing these iconic people that spoke to him in his own life process. How that's what I was trying to ask earlier. How's it been, or was there some directive from Mr. Harper to focus on a particular part of his collection, the athlete, the artist, the advocate? Was there a particular part that he had some urgency to have presented to the public, or is it just the breadth of his work?
There was no real directive on what to do. I had to make some of these decisions, and truthfully, of the images that he has digitized, I used all but three. And the reason I didn't use the others is just because they were small, right? And so I really wanted people to see his voice, his you know, creativity as large a size as possible. And so, you know, what we did learn, Larry and I, is that there are a number of pieces, perhaps as many as that are on the wall today, in his basement that we haven't digitized yet.
I was curious about that and how
we're going after it, buddy.
Preserved. Right. So yeah. Talk me through the process. I like this print. Like Mr. Harper said, he had a commission from Mr. Turner, but he also was gifted a piece from Mr. Turner.
What a gift.
So right, there you are. So walk me through, I purchased a piece of art today, but I also would like to purchase maybe another piece of art, and if I could, an original piece of art. Is that a possibility? And are there, just walk me through the process of art acquisition.
Yeah.
If I wanted to say in a different size,
yeah,
or something that's not represented in the collection that we see here. So, is that a possibility?
So I'll deal with the original print aspect. So these are not originals. These are digitized of the original. And this is a business model choice, right? I mean, so we have to kind of think about the fact that he's got an estate, and we want to continue to be able to, for him to, his estate to benefit from this over time. So if we sold originals, it meant that only one person would get Clapton ever. And that seems wrong to me. It seems like art is meant to be appreciated by many, not just one. Now that has nothing to do with me as far as their decision. They had already made the decision long before it got to me that they were going to put these prints, these digitized prints, on the internet. So that was a decision that the family had made long before. I just kind of kicked it into gear a tad. And so when Larry came to me to rebuild the website that they had originally had, I don't know how to do anything other than turn it into a true business. So relative to if somebody wants to buy or purchase, these come in various sizes. So one of the things I had to do was decide what sizes do I bring into this show.
Exhibit, yeah.
Yeah. And so, you know, as a curator, I you know, it's hard for me to say how do you choose? But how do you choose your favorite dog, your favorite child, your favorite, right? I mean, it's kind of the same thing. So what I wanted to do was to make sure we had the impact with the best historical images that we have. So I made some decisions as far as that. But truthfully, there's no way to not list all of Herschell Turner's art because it's so impressive. And there's, like I said, there's so many pieces from when I started to research him that aren't even in my possession yet. So there's a lot of work out there of Herschell Turner, and it's sad to think that sometimes it has to be late in your life before you receive that notoriety for what is your
many
biggest
times posthumously.
Right? And so let's try to help Herschell Turner and his estate, you know, that recognition, whether that means that you're sharing his work online or you're talking about it. But just always remember that, you know, there's not a lot of African-American artists, much less there's no African-American artist like Herschell Turner. You'll never find another artist like this in your lifetime.
So as far as we know right now, this is actually the range of the complete works that are available to date.
Yep.
Right.
Yep.
Right. And then the exceptionality, just to talk back through it, even from to my mind, is that these are rendered in canvas because
yes.
there are others that might be on paper
yes.
or like prints, but
yes.
these are actual. Speak to me about
so,
that.
When I started the project, Herschell had a very specific paper that he wanted to print on, as most artists do. And so we definitely made sure that we used this very specific paper that would really show his art in the best way. But if we're printing on paper for a show, it now means we have to frame everything with glass, right? And so that's probably not the best way for us to show that. And personal preference, I like canvas. So that's why you're getting canvas today versus prints in glass, because that just is a personal preference of mine. To me, it feels much more original that way. But again, everybody has their own personal preference. So one of the things I will say to you that I learned from taking this artwork home, and one of the things that we are offering because we know that COVID exists and COVID is on all of our minds, is we are going to offer private guided tours, both in gallery and virtually. So if there's somebody that might want to see Herschell's work, we will shut down the gallery and offer them a 60-minute tour and I will go through and talk about each piece and share the knowledge and the things that I've learned about Herschell and his, you know, why he's choosing to paint what he's choosing. So that's a particular option. But the other thing that I learned when I took these prints home, a couple of the prints home, was this is what I said, and you guys have probably all said the same thing. Oh, I wish it was a little bigger. Or, ooh, if it was just a little smaller, it would fit in the spot really well. So one of the things that we're offering on our high-end premium private tour for those that are the serious art collectors is this try before you buy concept. So what we'll allow you to do is after the show, with a deposit, take one of the prints home and try it before you buy it. So then that way you can decide, do I need it bigger? Do I need it smaller? Would I rather have it canvas or would I rather have it printed and matted and framed? And so, you know, that might be something that for a lot of people helps make that decision for you. And so we do have some handouts for that. I will also put that information online for those that are watching online. But, you know, everybody has their own personal favorite, and I'm sure you will too. And, you know, why not have that in your home at the size that you would like?
So, and those are available through the Loomis Brands website, or?
Those will be available. Actually, we'll have you contact me directly, Karen Loomis. So it's Karen@loomisbrands.com. Or you can call me, and we'll put the phone number up there as well. And we will customize an order for you. So if you have some very specific needs or wants or desires, you know, contact me. We can set up a online virtual tour or in gallery tour. We can talk about the piece. We can, you know, you can bring your designer. Or, you know, the other option is, you know, if you have a pod of 10 people that you guys have kind of COVIDed together to kind of create this bubble, maybe you want to bring them in for a private tour. or maybe education, school groups. You know, we're also open to schools, small groups for school as well, because one of the things that we cannot forget about this artwork is the history lessons that are
shared. That
was
what I was going to contextualize, to say that it's not just iterative, it is historical, mm-hmm. and has this breadth of relevance,
yes.
that is unique, certainly to this artist, and the fact that it's, and quite a poignant story right now in America. Mm-hmm. Mr. Harper and I were talking about that earlier, to say that these are a commentary, you know, on some of the things that we were talking about in the 60s, now in the 70s, mm-hmm. and we didn't think that we would be continuing to talk about them in 2020 yeah. or 21. But there you are. So is there any question that might be presented from the audience that I could bring to Mrs. Loomis?
Yeah, I have one. Thank you for presenting all of this. It's amazing artwork.
It is amazing.
I'm astounded by how beautiful it is. Is there a limit to the number of digital copies made, or is it like a lithograph where there's a certain number done, or is it unlimited, or could you put one order 300 copies of a particular one if you wanted one?
Yeah.
Or how does that work?
So for those of us at home, or for those of you at home watching online, she's asking about the limited quantity and or the iteration of the number of prints available and how they're being categorized and sold.
So I will tell you this, we haven't sold many. So if you're buying a print today, you're probably buying a print that is one of five out there. There's not many of them out there. There just isn't. Herschell Turner, being from Grand Rapids, has done most of his exhibits in that area. So, you know, that's been one of the key things about bringing Herschell Turner's artwork to this Phoenix Sedona market area, is to get that exposure, that greater exposure. But truthfully, I'm not putting a massive marketing advertising plan behind to where we become, like, let's put Herschell Turner in every hotel there is. Nah, that's not really gonna be our thing. But if there was, you know, I think that Herschell Turner's artwork really appeals to those that have a real honest respect for history and an appreciation for history.
So, and the other thing that Mr. Harper contextualized earlier on is that Mr. Turner originally was a commissioned artist. So there are a number of original pieces mm-hmm. that exist in the world. They're just
somewhere.
Right. With his peers in the entertainment and the sports industry. However, this is significant because of Mrs. Loomis and Mr. Harper. We're now able to have access mm-hmm. to these originals that he's kind of kept as, you know, even I think that, what is the statistic that Picasso sold 500 pieces to the world and hoarded 5,000, you know, before he gave up to his heirs the right to be able to monetize the collection. So there's a bit of that that I mm-hmm. hear, but that speaks to the exceptionality. And then this, from what I'm understanding, Karen, is exceptional because of its being rendered in canvas before, except for a commissioned piece, they're all posters, lithos on paper.
Yes. I would say the other thing that you have to consider about a Herschell Turner is, I think that, and I don't know this for a fact, but I think he painted the things that he felt like we needed to learn, the lessons that we needed to learn in life. And one of the commentaries that, you know, one of the questions that we asked him is, you know, who would you have liked to have painted that you couldn't, that you didn't? And he mentioned Eric Dyson, and I'm not sure if you guys are familiar with Eric Dyson out of Vanderbilt, but he's worth looking up. But his comment was, and you have to listen very carefully to understand what he's saying. He said, I think our youth needs to see him in portrait. Because when you see things in portrait, you're allowed to render your own discoveries and explorations in the things you see and on your own life lessons. But when you read things in words, the words are the words, right? So that's what's really phenomenal about, I think, Herschell Turner, is that not only did he paint these historical images and legends and icons, these people at the top, and not only at the top, but maybe might have fallen a tad, right? He still painted them, and I think that what he really wanted us to understand is how unique and how varied, and all of us have some good and bad in us, and all of us have that chance to be successful and the chance to fail. And so if you look at all of this, there's so much inspiration for people in their lives. And I want that to be the thing that we take away. Not only the fact that as Herschell Turner, who was born in the late 30s, walked his life very parallel with the MLKs of the world and those types of activists, but he also did his own work too in Grand Rapids to try to help us move forward. You know, and so the conversation often is, have we come forward from the 40s, the 50s, and the 60s? Have we progressed? And my usual answer is, before you're even done, is no. But maybe, you know, somebody like our Herschell Turner, you know, we asked him that question, and he kind of had the same response too, that we haven't come as far. And that's got to be a great disappointment, to think that in 80 years of your life, you would hope that humanity would be less oppressive and more supportive of the African Americans. And that's the sadness.
Well, it's a poignant visual commentary, especially at the moment that we're in with the intersectionality of culture and society. So I thank you so much, Karen. How much longer is the exhibit going to be here? And talk to us about that.
So today's opening day, and so we will go till February 14th. And February 14th, obviously, is Valentine's Day. But the significance of this show is that we're doing it within a show. So we're combining it with Camilla's B. Luther Hatchie show that's coming up here. Opening night is February 5th. And so she has six shows, six performances. And that's why you see the artwork up here, because it will be part of her stage and part of her performance. So if you can buy tickets to join us for the opening night of that, but the show will be February 5th, 6th, and 7th, and again the following weekend, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. And Alejandra will also be here providing vittles. Yeah, right? So on opening night, we will be doing Taste of the Islands in advance of the start of the play. And then on the last night of the play, which is Valentine's Day, she will be providing some of her yummy baked goods. They're so good.
So as an entry to Black History Month and as a continuation of the exhibit here, you've been a marvelous person to interview. And thank you for curating the Herschell Turner exhibit and bringing it here to us at the Sedona Art Center. Thank you.
Thank you.